the essence of the kind of core, the heart of Buddhism, its very essence is to awaken individuals to out of just habitual conditioned behavior, to awaken to reality. And so, like in the word Buddha itself, it's not a name of a person really, it means awakened, like a human being who is awakened to reality. And then you may wonder what I mean by reality, because most of us think, you know, the world we live in, our own thoughts and experiences are the real world, is reality. But it's not. We live in a world we create out of our fears and desires. And so then the Buddhist teaching is to awaken out of that realm of fear and desire to Dhamma, like the Pali word Dhamma is like reality, the truth, the absolute truth, the way things really are. And so then the practice of meditation is ways of developing that and learning to recognize within your own mind reality, not in terms of cultural assumptions or personal preferences or even religion, but it's an awakeness to what is natural, what is true, and of course you can't describe it. It's not. Descriptions, definitions are limited to our thinking process. And so we live in a world that we create with our own conditioned perceptions. And then the mindfulness practice is the developing awareness of that, you know, not just getting caught in the momentum of our thinking and views and opinions, but being able to observe them from a position of awareness and understanding, not in terms of worldly values, but in terms of the reality of existence. So we're now living in a world, you know, we have to live within the limitation of our physical form, our body, and the body is a sensitive form. So we're born, you know, from our mothers, and we're conscious form, human form, and it's a sensitive form, you know, so your physical body itself, then we have seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching. We have a retentive memory, so we have to remember all kinds of things from the past. And so we become complicated because we identify totally with our physical form, with the body. And then when a baby's born, then it doesn't, you know, it's conscious, it has consciousness, which is natural. And then a body, a natural body, and then it feels, it has pleasure, pain, neutral sensations. It knows when it's hungry and pain and sleepy and so forth. So there's this kind of instinctual intelligence operating from the beginning. And it's just natural intelligence, not created by culture or personal identities. But then after that, then the mother, father, the society starts informing us. You know, you get reward and punishment, you know, you're a good boy, you're a bad boy, that kind of thing. You obey mom and she praises you, and you disobey and you get punished and so forth. So this is, you know, we're conditioned to try to to survive within the family and the social milieu that we're a part of. But we form an identity of a separate self, you know, an ego, and cultural identity, social identity, identity with your body, male or female, the identity with whether you're consider yourself, whether your parents love you or don't, or you form a sense of your self-worth in the early, you know, kind of gets fixed in the adolescent years. And all this is conditioned, you know, through, in Buddhist terms, through ignorance of reality. Just this just happens to us. Like an innocent child just absorbs, it's like a sponge, it just takes on what's ever around. It doesn't, you know, discriminate really. It just has to survive because it's helpless, dependent, you know, on the mother at first, totally dependent, and so forth. So it has to, you know, it picks up the feelings, the prejudices, the biases, the social identities, and all that from just through absorption. And then we form our identity as a individual person, personality, convention, you know, we identify with our ethnic background, our class, race, gender, and with the culture, with the religion. All these affect us and how we interpret experience and life. And then the Buddha's practice is to awaken to that. It's not a critical function. It's not like trying to get rid of it. It's just putting it in a context where we're no longer just helpless victims of our conditioning, of our habits. Otherwise, you know, otherwise we tend to, you know, be stuck if we're, you know, with a lot of fears and opinions and views that we acquire from others, and social attitudes, and so and that we have no perspective on. We operate, we interpret our experience, interpret our self-worth through these distortions. So that's why we suffer, you know, this sense of suffering, because we're living in a world that's not real, but which we don't know anything outside it. So the Buddha addressed this issue very, very directly with his first sermon in the Four Noble Truths teaching. So when he was enlightened 2,556 years ago or so, he awakened to reality. He saw Dhamma. So you've got these words, Buddha, Dhamma, and it's Buddha that knows Dhamma. These are Pali words, but they're quite significant because it's not me knowing Dhamma. You know, Ajahn Sumedho knows the Dhamma. It's like when you develop mindfulness practice, then your refuge is in knowing, in this Bhutto, in this awareness. So it's non-personal. And Dhamma isn't about, you know, a person. It's about reality. So within this limitation of a human form, we can awaken to ultimate reality. Even we have all these other, you know, we're living in a realm that's continuously pressing on us. You know, just look at your own life. How it's endless, you know, you're endlessly being irritated through the conditions around you, you know, day or night, heat or cold, the weather, by, you know, the alignment of the stars, the sun and the moon, and then the society you're in, and your own personal habits, and what we see, you know, hear, smell, taste, touch, think and feel. This is the experience of total sensitivity. You know, so every human being is in this state of total sensitivity from birth to death. In fact, all of the animals are, but we're aware of this. You know, we think about it. We have a retentive memory where we can create a totally false, totally deluded scenario of life and what, you know, self-worth and so forth. So we have endless wars, conflicts, disagreements, you know, with each other, or different national identities and religious identities, so we fight with each other about these, or class identities. You know, so when you look at, read the news, you know, it's all about this ignorance of one group, you know, saying we're right, you're wrong, you're the enemy, and so forth. It's all just, you know, ever since I was born, it's been going on, and no doubt before. But and this is because of this ignorance, this not knowing Dhamma, not awakening to reality. And so now we have a population of what, 9 billion or so people on the planet, and when I was born, there were about 2 billion or something. So I mean, just in 80 years, it's so. I mean, you know, we have, you know, how do we relate to, you know, this world is pressuring. It's like a pressure cooker now, and everything's, you know, fast, moving fast with the technology, and in one, some ways it's better, in some ways it's getting worse. But this is the way conditioned phenomena operates. You know, as long as we're identified on this level of a human form, a human personality, social, cultural identities, political identities, personal views and opinions, then, you know, our life is going to be one of conflict, because nobody can have the same views. You know, you can't get 9 million people to think in the same way or believe in the same God or whatever, just, or have the same political, you know, we all prescribe, you know, now democracies, the word, you know, everybody wants democracy, but what do we mean by that? Nobody quite knows anymore. It's kind of a generic term that includes, you know, how do you define it? But it's, you know, an ideal we have of, you know, a fair government. But, you know, the samsara isn't about fairness, it's about change. It's not about equality and peace, it's about conflict and change and suffering, pain, so we have the natural force, like the cyclone in the Philippines recently, just last week, this devastating cyclone, you know, Mother Nature, or is it God's retribution? Maybe he's punishing the Filipinos. You can interpret any way you want, or you know, depending on your proclivity and the way you're conditioned to think. And so, like awakening to reality is learning to develop a trust in your ability to just observe. And so this is like mindfulness. Is the English word mindfulness? It means our ability to be in the to wake into the present moment. Usually, we're mindful about things like crossing a busy street. You know, you have to look right, left, and see what's coming. You have to bring into your attention out of self-preservation, just physical survival. You know, so you're not walking into the middle of an ongoing lorry or something that. But so we're mindful when we're supposed to be mindful when we're driving a car. And so you're not supposed to be drunk Or you're not supposed to be talking on your cell phone while you're driving. Especially, you know, the government now makes these rules wanting you to concentrate on, you know, the traffic in front and the signs and that, to be mindful, because you're driving a dangerous vehicle. You know, you could kill people with it. And so driving is, you know, it's about survival. You've got to, you know, be on the alert just for survival. If you're a rock climber, you know, you talk to rock climbers about that, they're totally mindful. I asked one once, I said, why do you do that? You know, it's so dangerous. You know, you're climbing these sheer cliffs and you've got to, you know, just one misstep, one false move, you could just fall, drop, and die. And they said, well, you know, when you're climbing a rock face, you're not worrying anymore. You're just totally with the situation. You know, you can't have to worry about paying the electric bill or your relationship with your wife. You've got to be with just the reality of your body on the rock face. And that is, you know, because of the imminent threat of death. You know, it's very, you know, it's right there in your face. So you don't, you forget everything else and just concentrate on what you're doing, where your hands are, your feet. But in daily life, you know, we like security, and we have locks on the doors, and we have central heating and air conditioning, and we can go into our flat, and, you know, from climbing a rock face, get back to your flat, lock the door, and you got this sense of safety. And so you could sit there and, you know, think about climbing the rock face and suddenly start shaking with fear. Because just the memory, you know, what you really put yourself into, it can be very frightening when you think about it. So our human minds are like this. When danger is that, we have an instinctual self-preservation mechanism. Probably you've experienced it when your life, physical existence has been threatened. Something in you opens immediately to the situation, and you react in a way that you can't believe, you know, you could do it, because how you see yourself when you're in your cozy flat, safe from everything, is not the same person that's having to face something very dangerous in the immediate present. So one time here, in this very monastery, I was living in a kuti, and it had a bathroom underneath, and then the room was above that with a porch. And so I was going down, I went into the bathroom, and there were just little cement cubicles. I closed the door, put the latch on, and I turned around, there was a cobra there in the same, you know, it's a very small place. And it was coming at me like this. And my response was, surprised me when I started thinking about it, you know, suddenly I saw, and immediately I just leaped over this angry cobra and opened the door and got out. And then the cobra left. And when I started thinking about it, I started shaking with fear, because, you know, here I was trapped. And yet, I wouldn't have been able to think that out. I didn't, but I must leap over this cobra. It was spontaneous. And so maybe many of you have had these kind of experiences where you're actually physically endangered and you respond in a way that can be quite amazing, you know, that you had not planned, but it was a spontaneous response to danger. We have that, but so much of life now is safe, you know, has this illusion of safe security, and we can become neurotic in that security. We can sit in our cozy flats and stir up anger and hatred and resentment and feeling sorry for ourselves and get really, you know, neurotic, create endless scenarios of problems in our mind because of the safety. You can't do that climbing a rock face. You've got to just be with the moment. So like this is the, like the mindfulness practice then is we're not trying to seek dangerous situations, you know, to be mindful, but as a place like this, you know, it's fairly, people are trustworthy and we all have a standard of morality and we make agreements on how to live with each other, so we're not, you know, we're not kind of in a situation that we have to compete with each other or defend ourselves. So there's a certain amount of safety, a moral standard, encouragement of practice, mindfulness. And then to develop this mindfulness in ordinary situations. You know, so you're not going to wait until a cobra's chasing you, but here and now when everything is, you know, nothing much, there's no present danger, no immediate need to be mindful. But this, the vipassana practices of the Buddha are about awakening and being mindful here and now. And so that is, you know, that's what we do, to cultivate this mindfulness in our daily lives. Don't worry about it when your life's in danger, but where we are most in danger is in the seeming security and safety of daily life, where we can really, you know, that's where people commit suicide or, you know, do terrible things in a society that where there's guaranteed safety laws and policemen and CCTV cameras and guard dogs and locks, rules and whatnot to have this sense of security. So, you know, over the years, this is mainly what I've done. I've been a monk now 48 years. So, it's like developing this. First you have a kind of, you have the insight, kind of flashes of awareness. And that kind of awakes you, you know, there's something beyond just the momentum of your own mind and your own habits as you begin to be more aware of them. And this awareness is now, you know, it as you begin to recognize it and trust it, then it integrates into the flow of your life, whatever that might be, you know, whether you're a monk or a nun or lay person or living in Thailand or in another country. It's not about, it is not dependent upon a situation, but it integrates into whatever you have to do with your life, you know, the people you live with and the position you're in. And now, like I've lived in England for 34 years teaching like this, and I went to London in 1977 because there was an interest there, and there was a lot of I was invited to go. And this awareness now practices is, you know, you hear it all the time. You know, psychotherapy and everything is now beginning to recognize the value of these practices. Where, in 1977 in London, the psychologists, psychotherapists, I never heard them talk about mindfulness or awareness. And it was a word that just wasn't in the consciousness. And meditation, man. You know, you told people you were practicing, they think you were doing something really strange. What's that? You know, and it's like some kind of strange Asian practice. Now everybody does it. It's common. You know, it's even on the national health system in UK, meditation practice. Because it works. It is a way to resolve your own kind of problems, and of course it's not invasive. You don't have to swallow medicine or inject things into your body. You're just learning to pay attention, and your attention isn't just looking out. Like if we pay attention, you know, we tend to look outward, and then our critical mind starts operating, you know, I don't like this, we become aware of what's wrong and the things that don't suit us, say, externally. And we're, you know, educated people are like this, we develop our critical faculty to a high degree. We read a lot, we have a lot of information. We know what's right and wrong and true and false and good and bad and that. So, you know, our educational system, our culture, fulfills its role of developing our critical faculties, our thinking mind. The thinking mind is for discriminating. This is big, small, good, bad, and so forth. So it has its use. But if we operate only from the critical mind, then we end up with doubt and resentments, and we don't get beyond the critical conditioning. And so then the intuitive awareness, like I use the word intuition, because I mean an English word, but it really is like being mindful in the moment. When you're intuitive, it's in the present moment. You know, it's not about the past or the future, it's about the present. And it's you kind of pick up in a general way. You know, you're aware, say, of the atmosphere or the feeling of the moment, you know, both internally and externally. You know, we have this ability to feel life rather than just project our own views, opinions on everything and ignore it. And so then what impinges on us affects our minds. So even a hostile atmosphere where maybe nobody's showing any kind of outward hostility, but inwardly they hate you, you can feel it. You know, this is an intuitive intelligence operating. So it's a discerning ability. It's to discern. It's not a critical, it's not saying you shouldn't hate me. It's not about how you should be or that, but it's discerning. It's like this. So it's not descriptive, it's just noticing. And in the present, you, because of the sensitivity of your position and things around you, it's like this. And so it's undefinable, but recognizable, realizable. And this is how you begin to train yourself with this awareness, because you know, it's not from, because The external things also affect you, your emotional nature, and then you feel this kind of anxiety maybe, or threat. But if you're just thinking all the time, and you're very idealistic, caught up in the realm of your own views, opinions, and self-importance, then you don't recognize what you're feeling. You can ignore it and just go on a tirade about, you know, we've got to get rid of this dictator and build a democracy and plan a revolution and plans for the future. So, but that's why we can think of, we can create ideals of perfection with our thinking mind, because we can think high or low, we can think the ultimate best, you know, where everybody loves each other. We're all filled with metta and compassion, loving kindness and compassion. That's an ideal, you know, a beautiful ideal, and it should be like that. But this is the way it is right now, you see. So you're not, you know, if you're not, and so the way it is right now is like this, and that maybe it's not like that. Maybe at this moment nobody's loving each other, they're all caught up in anger, resentment, hatred, and views and opinions. But, and so it's, then if one is attached to these high-minded ideals, then you always feel anxiety and threat, because, you know, we all should love each other, but this is not the way it is, but it should be like the ideal, but, and it shouldn't be this way. Now the intuitive awareness then is the ability to observe that, you know, how we react, our habitual reactions to situations. And through that awareness, you begin to put your ability to create ideal situations, your views, opinions, your emotional reactions to the experience of the moment, the anxiety, the fear, restlessness, infatuations, whatever is like this. You see, and this is where wisdom operates. And this is like a higher intelligence or universal intelligence. It's not conditioned by culture. It's not cultural. It's not religious even. It's universal. So we all share this. We all have this ability, but we're limited always by our own the limitations we impose on our consciousness all the time. So over the years, like the training with Lungpa Cha, and over these years of, you know, developing this practice, you know, you can actually, you know, prove this to yourself. It's not a matter of just accepting the Lungpa Cha's word or my word or the Buddha's word in the scriptures, but it's to be, you know, recognized in your, you know, for yourself. So it's not just secondhand or acquired knowledge. It's insight knowledge. It's like the taste of honey. You know, you can describe. If you've never tasted honey, and I say it's really delicious, you know what delicious means, and it's very sweet, you know, like sugar, you know what sweet sugar is. You say, what's the chemical formula? I could look up on the internet chemical formula for honey and give you that. And but only till you taste it do you really know the flavor. And then you know for yourself, you know, you're not depending on me to tell you, you know, how wonderful it is. It's as simple as that. It's tasting, knowing directly. Now, do you have any questions?
How do we know? know, between reality and view.
Because, like with mindfulness, your views are always formed with thoughts. You know, you have to think to have a viewpoint. But the intuitive awareness is awareness of thinking. So this is where, you know, usually we experience what we think is real. We have to have a name. You know, this is real, because we call this a spittoon, and it's solid, you can see it. And we all agree, you know. The Thais don't call this a spittoon, they call it a gaton. Gaton? Gaton. And, but we all know that you spit into it. And so that's the real world for many people, you know. You have a definite form that everybody agrees that this is what it's for. And you know, like in the West, we never, you know, we didn't really use them. And then this was years ago in England, some wealthy Thai woman gave me a spittoon, a big one like this, had a brass rim, it was blue paint, you know, designs on white, quite beautiful. And so I thought, well, this is too beautiful to spit into. So what I did was I filled it with sand, put it on the shrine to put joss sticks in. So, and all of us, you know, international, there weren't Thai monks there at the time, just, you know, from different European countries. So they, you know, nobody had any objection to it. And then one evening, very high-ranking Thai monk came, and a very famous one. He came into Chithurst, and we took him to the shrine room, and he saw the spittoon on the shrine, and he said, "No, no, you can't do that. That's for spinning into." And then, like, that's that. You know, you, now I couldn't do that because I don't see this is what you spin into, but. Before I could see it like a vase or a dish or whatever, you know, and defined it as only for spitting. And this is what we do with life. We get very fixed in the, you know, with the conditions we have, and this is the what it's for, and you can't use it for anything else. And so the mind, you know, before I started meditating, I realized something was wrong with, you know, I had felt suffocated with my own thinking process. And, you know, just felt, you know, that it's like wearing straitjacket. It was always pressing in. It's too narrow. Is there something outside of that that you can, you know, get out of this trap of just being stuck in your own thoughts and opinions and views, fears and desires? And this is one reason why I had already had an interest in Buddhism, but I never practiced it, never developed it. I'd read about it, and mainly in the Zen Buddhist type of Buddhism, which was the popular form at that time in the States. And that I found, you know, hopeful with that, because Zen Buddhism has, you know, it has this kind of opening the mind up in a different way that the American system doesn't. You know, it's a completely different kind of take on reality. And it fascinated me, but I didn't know how to do it. And that's one reason why I came to Thailand, to find somebody to teach me how to do that.
Given the 48 years of your presence in the Buddhist world, and you've seen it grow, especially, and I'm referring specifically to the Western Sangha and the Western practice of Buddhism, and you've seen it, and you've played a key role in this growth. Where do you see it going in the next, say, 50 years?
Well, it's really, it's developed beyond, even in my lifetime, beyond what I've expected. And, I've been invited all over the world, and it was, there's an interest in Buddhist meditation in almost every country. And, this is a good sign. And now now you've got, everything's on the internet, and you easily get, information about Buddhism and different schools of Buddhism and teachers and whatnot. So this wasn't possible back when I became interested around 1955. I was in the American Navy and in Japan in Zen Buddhism. And then there wasn't much available in English. I think Alan Watts, The Way of Zen, and they were republishing D.T. Suzuki's, he was a Japanese master, but he wrote in English. And they'd been out of print for, I never heard of them before. I think they'd been published in the 30s, 1930s, and of course they weren't generally known by anybody. And they started publishing those in paperbacks in America. So I got, in San Francisco, I went to a bookshop and found this book on Zen Buddhism by D.T. Suzuki. And something in me just, I was about 21 years old then, so it was, like an awakening for me. I used to go out in Golden Gate Park by myself, just read D.T. Suzuki and get high on it. I didn't need marijuana or anything. D.T. Suzuki did it. And because something in me responds to this style. I don't know why, because I'm brought up as a Christian. I'm not, in my cultural, social background don't explain it in any way. What it is, I don't know, but I certainly relate to Buddhism in a way I don't relate to anything else. And I followed that over the years. But I thought, you think of yourself as, you're kind of an odd character anyway, and I used to think of myself as just not really fitting well into this society I was born into, a misfit. And even though I could get by, it was generally good experience with life, but it was a feeling. And I couldn't relate to Christianity. I just, didn't reach me. I couldn't believe it. Where with Buddhism, because they don't ask you to believe in anything, then I could trust that. Because I have a skeptical mind. It's a doubting mind. And of course Zen Buddhism addresses that. All there are always these koans that don't make any sense, throw your mind into what is it? Sound of one hand clapping, your mind goes blank, impossible conundrums, they throw at you. Because that really, it's a way of getting to look at your consciousness, not knowing. When you're brought up in a society where you're supposed to know a lot, and you're praised for knowing all kinds of facts and figures and details and all that, not knowing is just not acceptable. It's just, you should know, have something defined, have it categorized, labeled. But not knowing is like you're stupid, or you should know. And so when I would be thrown into the state of doubt or not knowing, then I'd, you know, I always wanted an answer, a solution to a problem, answer to a question. But then in the mindfulness practice, you're aware of that. And then Ajahn Chah's great teaching is not don't know. You know, so he's in Thai, my nair. My nair in Thai means don't know. And so this doesn't sound like anything worth knowing. But what it is my nair and not don't know is, you know, it's like if you're willing to not know something and accept that, you're aware of pure consciousness, the reality of pure consciousness. You know, it's a discerning. It's here and now. It's realizable. But you can't know it as an object. Like this, you can know as an object. But consciousness, because we're all experiencing it right now, it's all the same. But we don't know consciousness. We operate from reacting to the stimulation of our that goes through the consciousness. So in the and that's what we live in, this realm of irritation, agitation, change, and time elements and fears and desires all come into that. But beyond all these moving things is pure consciousness. And it's the same for all of us. It's not a personal consciousness. Not I have it and you don't or something. It's exactly the same for all of us. And so when we recognize that, then we have perspective on what we have to deal with, our own karmic habits or contingencies or things that happen to us in life. We have perspective. We're not just helplessly trapped in maybe unwholesome reactions and fears and things that we tend to be if we don't know this. Like fear is, you know, this is a fear realm we're living in. It's all about death and survival. So we have these very vulnerable bodies to live in, you know, and they're very sensitive and vulnerable, and anything could happen to them. And so there's a natural anxiety and fear about survival, you know, just as a physical entity. Our skin is not very tough, not like rhinoceros. We can't compete with gazelles in running. To tackle an elephant, we know we lose. so, or a raging lion. And so, I mean, we're kind of a species that, you know, we don't have much hair, we don't have really good claws, and how do we survive? You know, we have this intelligence, you know, where we can create weapons and for protection, and bows and arrows and axes and nuclear bombs and whatnot. So, I mean, this is how to use this intelligence just for survival or protection for me or for our country or whatever. But we know that how dangerous it is now with nuclear power. And no longer bows and arrows and swords. It's, you know, mass destruction is potential now worldwide. So this creates anxiety. This realm is like this, you know, this is a realm of fear. And you just watch the animals in the jungles here. You know, they operate on survival. It's all about survival. But we can, you know, the human society, we can make moral agreements and laws about behavior. So we all agree, you know, that murdering somebody else is wrong. And yet we can all have moments where we want to murder somebody. So it's not that that we're, you know, we never experienced that impulse, but we have a moral agreement not to do it. And then we're punished by the society if we do. And so this is one of the, you know, the good things of our human state. We still have these animal instincts and reactions to things, but we can agree on behavior. You know, not to murder each other or lie to each other. In monasticism, we have this vinaya, we have very, you know, detailed precepts about behavior and speech. And that's why it works, because we, you know, this is Wat Pananachat International Forest Monastery, so you've got every nationality around. But we all, you know, if you become a bhikkhu, then you agree to live under the structure of Vinaya. And it makes our life, we live with each other then. It doesn't mean we like each other, love each other, agree with each other. But we respect, we have forms of respect and ways of dealing, you know, in which we agree on the behavioral level. What we feel personally is going to be different with every individual. And this makes our life easy, because we can live with each other like this. Because of these agreements. Now, to me, this is what the greatness of being human. Because we can, because, you know, I've seen it myself, all the, you know, desires, you know, jealousies and fears and anger and rage and liking and disliking and resenting and so forth, because you're mindful of what's going on inside you. But on the behavior level, we try to live within that structure. And now, you know, like worldwide, the infinite problems of peace agreements and resolving conflicts, there's not a moral structure involved in it. It was power. And like not killing, you know, nobody, it's all right to kill if it's your enemy. And, you know, President Obama can send a drone over and kill somebody in Pakistan. It's just, you know, part of his duty to wipe out the enemy, even though it's in another country. But if you know, our the first precept is the bana dibat, not to intentionally kill another human, and that is an important moral agreement. But you know, if all the world decided to keep that one precept, the war would stop. You're not supposed to go around killing the enemies anymore. This is where, you know, we lack that wisdom now. We don't have that understanding. We just think the end justifies the means. You know, so you invade Iraq, kill millions of Iraqis. I mean, it's, you know, collateral damage. We're sorry about it, but it's necessary. Sorry about that. You know, it's dismissed as, you know, well, you know, we're very sorry, you know, but We got rid of Saddam Hussein. So it's, you know, nobody feels a sense of moral integrity about it. And this is, you know, if we're going to 9 billion people can live with each other, it's very important to bring into the mind. You can't force it on them. You can't, you know, it's something you have to take on. You know, like moral precepts, there's something you have to recognize. You know, if I say you should keep the five precepts and force them on you, it won't work. Then you just feel tyranny from me. You know, you just see that monk's just browbeating me into doing this, and you just feel my tyranny. You don't recognize maybe the profundity of the precepts you've taken. So that's why in here in Thailand, to take the five precepts, you have to ask for them. You know, we can't say you have to take them. You have to come to a monk and say, please may I have the five precepts. And you have to say it three times before the monk can do it. So that makes it, you know, something that you rise up to. You're not just being told what to do by a priest, but you're actually taking on that in your own request. And that's a mature way, you know, because you know, if I just tell you, you go to hell if you don't keep the five precepts, you'll never grow up. Even if you believe me and keep the five precepts, you know, you need always to be told what to do. Where rather than being told, you're encouraged to contemplate the value of this, and then ask for it, and then try to live within that structure. It's just about decent behavior towards yourself and others. So what is it like being human being? You know, we're strange animals, really. We've got the animal body, you know, not that much different from a chimpanzee. And then we've got this reflective mind. We have to remember everything. So, you know, we have to remember all kinds of things we wish we could forget because of this retentive memory. So one time I was walking in the north of England in the in Yorkshire Dales. I was on this kind of camping trip, and I was with another monk and a layman, and we came in the springtime in the Yorkshire Dales. Is really beautiful, you know, it's kind of wildflowers and beautiful feeling of spring, and then these hills, and I heard this terrible kind of wailing in the distance. I didn't know what it was, so I asked the layman who knows the area, I hear this kind of wailing sound, what is it? And he said, oh, that's probably, you know, on the other side of the hill, the shepherd just took away the newborn lambs from their mothers. And the mothers are grieving the loss of their lambs. And this was, you know, I could hear this. This was just like a human woman crying, you know, if you took a baby away from its mother. This is grief. So actually, sheep, ewes, experience grief and loss. And we have that same experience. Grief at the loss of the loved is common to us and sheep. But sheep don't remember that much longer, so they get over it quickly. But a human woman, it could ruin her life. It could, you know, destroy her life And she'd be caught in resentment, anger, because of her memory, retentive memory. So that is, this is the curse of having a retentive memory, but the good thing is that it gives us this reflective ability, you know, to reflect on experience, to have language, to describe and define things. But the wisdom level is not about the value of things, but of discerning the difference between, like, the purity of consciousness and the conditions that arise in it. So, you know, like they say, all conditions are impermanent. All conditioned phenomena is impermanent. Sape sangharani cha. And so it's a statement of to be reflected on. And then that which is aware of conditions, it's not, awareness isn't picking and choosing the conditions, where that what the feeling now, the experience now through the senses, and that is, and we reflect on the changingness of it rather than on what we think of it and our opinion about it, whether we want it or don't want it, just like this. So your mind is open in this wide spectrum of awareness and discerns this change, both internally, you know, in subtle ways or coarse ways. And this is intuitive intelligence. And this is where, when, in Buddhist term, where wisdom operates, where we understand in a profound way, rather than just think we understand because we know the theories that we've acquired from others. And but the, you know, in 1955, when I became interested in Buddhism, there was this kind of, in San Francisco, this kind of beat Zen thing going on, which was a beginning, really, a beginning where, you know, these kind of rebellious people, young people, were rebelling against the status quo of the kind of white middle-class Protestant mentality. It was so kind of fixed and rigid. So, I mean, they were like thumbing their nose, making fun of and condemning, doing everything you shouldn't be doing if you were a good Christian, Protestant, white, middle-class girl or boy. Did everything the opposite, which was kind of fun, you know, to rebel against the establishment. But also there was this growing interest in Zen Buddhism because it seemed like a kind of rebellion or different way of thinking. And then many of us started with that, and then of course the beatnik thing didn't last very long, but it was a sign of a change. Because ever since 1955, there's it's been this growing interest in countries that are not Buddhist at all, like Britain or United States, all over. You know, now it's everywhere, and that's a good thing. How it moves into the society, I don't know. But I do know, like in England, for example, the psychotherapists are talking a lot about mindfulness now, which they didn't, you know, before. And there's mindfulness practices, and this is quite in the States, and these are quite, you know, they're recognizing this in a kind of worldly way, the value of resolving a lot of your emotional habits through awareness. I think that's good, you know, it's a good direction to encourage. Because, you know, the who knows what's going to happen, you know, in the future, is unknown. And, but that's why I encourage you to trust yourself to know now, you know, not don't worry about the future, but to develop this awareness practice now, so that whatever the changes might be, you'll be able to adapt and survive within the changing conditions that you have no control over, if you have this kind of wisdom available. And even in different religions, it, you know, that, like Christian mysticism, you read, you know, what is Saint John of the Cross, or that, and they refer to it, but it's not so clearly stated. It's more or less by default. Where in the Buddhist practice, it's the main teaching. Like in why did he take suffering and place it in the top, the noble truth, first noble truth. And you go to interfaith meetings in London and other religions, and they all ask, well, Buddhism doesn't believe in God, you don't have a God. Why do you always talk about suffering? You know, we talk about love and God and those, you know, and you talk about suffering. So it makes you think, you know, why? Where love and God are kind of inspiring, you know, especially for most people, love. He's talking about love and people get very inspired by that. But and God, some people really, you know, find that inspiring. Other people just get angry about it. But these are, you know, words that are, that tend to inspire the mind. Inspiration is, you know, gives you, you know, it has its purpose, but it has no self-sustaining ability. You can't, you know, you can't, you know, it comes and then it goes, and then you have to find something to inspire you again. So the Buddha used suffering, which is not inspiring, but which is, we all suffer, you know, it's easily seen. You know, every one of us, you know, whether you're rich or poor, whatever, has the same thing. It's banal. It's ordinary. It's what none of us want. None of us want it. We want to get rid of it. But then you're changing from running away, seeking happiness, ignoring suffering, to understanding it. That's a significant shift. You know, as an individual human, you're just changing from just trying to find happiness and to looking at suffering, not indulging in it, but it's a noble truth, so not just something you have to grit your teeth and endure because it's a nasty fact of life. It's not asking you to do that, grin and bear it. It's a look at it. You're changing from one reacting to it to observing it, and that's a very significant change a shift, like a quantum leap from being just an ordinary person seeking happiness to being an individual developing wisdom. And then as you follow that, the Four Noble Truths and the formula that I have, you begin to recognize non-suffering, like the pure consciousness is not, there's no suffering there. It's not a suffering reality. The suffering comes and goes in it. And if all we know is what comes and goes, then that's why we're worried, anxious, neurotic, frightened, resentful, and that, because we're caught in it. In just the momentum of change all the time, where with mindfulness and like intuitive awareness, you're transcending the condition. You're looking at it. You're not dismissing it or annihilating it. You're your relationship to it changes from becoming that condition to observing. It's this knowing. It's like this. So just to encourage you, it takes, like the big problem I found teaching in the West was people, well-educated, intelligent people tend to be very self-critical too. Like in England, there's people tend to emphasize the weaknesses, the faults they have as their reality. And so they tend to see themselves in negative perceptions. I'm not good enough, I can't do it, I'm an emotional mess, I've got to get rid of this. They kind of see their suffering, but they're identified with it. And that identity, you wanting to get them to look, that's a created identity, it's not what you really are, in a sense. But people tend to believe that these negative perceptions is what they really are. And so you're encouraging them to change, just shift from, to clinging to these identities and believing them to observing them. And if you can get somebody to do that, then they can, whatever problems they do have, their relationship to it changes from just being a helpless victim of their habits to being using wisdom to resolve and let go of the very things that make them suffer. And so it's like learning to trust this awareness. I used to tell myself, trust this awareness. And I used to think, like with Ajahn Chah, I trusted him more than myself in the beginning. He's the wise master. I'm the neurotic disciple. He knows. But I don't. So I want him to tell me, and because that's how it seemed at the time. He seemed wise, and I didn't. I didn't see myself as wise at all. So I trusted his view of me, and he saw that, and so he'd always say, he always pointed out, how should I know? You're the one that should know what's going on. And, he's always, when I would kind of tell me what to do next kind of thing, he'd get me to look at this kind of faith in him, not as something to annihilate or get rid of, but to see that it's what I create. And through that you begin to realize that it's not about finding somebody to tell you what to do or a wise teacher that knows exactly what you're thinking, but it's learning to trust this intuitive awareness ability we all have. Because like the self tends to doubt, I'm not good enough. And you think, well, I've done some terrible things in the past. And then you might think, oh, Ajahn Sumedho, he's not like me. and so these are all creations in your mind. And then the awareness of those creations is enough. They are what they are. It's not to say you shouldn't have them, but putting them in a context of an object rather than become that what you're attached to. You don't, you know, it's a becoming. If you don't do this, then you become what you're thinking, become what you're feeling.